Good morning and welcome to the Valley, Troy. I'm Shelley Rittenhouse and I'm just super glad that we have some time to spend together this morning. It is summer. It is my favorite season of the year. And I just truly love the organic feeling of this season. Like the same things I would wear to dress up are the same things I would wear to just dress down and be out all day. There's something about the ease of the weather that it's like, maybe I'll be inside, maybe I'll be outside. I don't know. What are some of your favorite things about summer? I personally have been enjoying being able, like, for it to be warm enough for me to be comfortable to go out and like go on walks in the morning when I wake up before my kids. That to me is just like a good quiet time to listen to a good podcast and get encouraged and a good perspective for the day. So hopefully we found you coming off of a good week, maybe coming off of a good morning. And we're just excited to spend together in God's word this morning. So sit tight and look at this bumper video as it previews our sermon series.
Hey everyone, I'm Pastor Mark at the Valley Church. It's so good to have you with us today. Before we dive into the sermon, I just want to share about baptism. I know some of you are watching locally, some of you are watching maybe in the state of Ohio where we are, maybe others of you are in different states or even different countries. And we want to let you know about baptism. We have a baptism service going on here on August 15th. So if you're watching today and you've never been baptized, and you've sensed that you're ready to make that step. You've said yes to Jesus, and that's, the Bible tells us this is the next step of obedience. Jesus himself was baptized. Talk to our host. Our host's going to ask, you know, to share maybe your baptism story if you're watching with us on Facebook. But if you've never been baptized, even if you're living in a different state, we'll figure this stuff out. Let us know. And we want to help you understand more about baptism. We'll have a class going on. We can do that virtually with you. And then we'll figure out the logistics of things. But we wanted to make sure our online audience, our e-family, if you will, was also included in knowing when baptisms are coming up. So again, if you're watching, especially on Facebook with our hosts, they'll love to answer any questions you might have right now or even throughout the service and help you take that next step in baptism. Such a huge thing. All of us who have been baptized remember and will never forget the moment we're baptized, because it is one of those pillars in our faith journey with Jesus Christ. Well, there's this show on National Geographic called Taboo. I don't know if you've ever watched it. I've never watched it yet. I was reading a description about it. It really caught my eye. And they say this as their kind of summary of what this TV show is all about. It says, "We delve into the bizarre or confronting practices of culture around the world." And they ask, what drives someone to insert stainless steel fishing hooks into another person's back so they can hang from the ceiling by their flesh? How is the practice of thrusting hands into gloves filled with stinging giant bullet ants and enduring the pain over and over acceptable within a culture? In some societies around the world, practices like these reflect deeply held religious beliefs or deliberate lifestyle choices. But to others outside the culture, they may seem grotesque, dangerous, or even taboo. Right. Wow, I might need to check out this show. Maybe you do need to, or maybe we don't. It kind of sounds creepy. But the subject of God's judgment and the subject of hell is kind of like that, is it not? It's taboo. It's one of those where when that conversation comes up, we're like, let's change the conversation. It's just something that makes us uneasy, makes us maybe a little bit uncomfortable. And so We've been journeying through the book of Revelation. Today is week 5 of our 6-week series. If you missed the previous 4 weeks, go check them out. And so we've been taking this journey through. We haven't covered every single chapter or verse, but we've been taking this journey through. And so we saw last week that God has the scroll in his hand and Jesus takes it from him. And when he first unseals that first scroll, it begins the judgment period, or specifically the tribulation period that goes on as God eventually makes all things right and eradicates evil forever. And so building off of that today, we're not going to go into all the different different seals that were open, 7 different seals. You can read that. It's like chapters 5 through 10 or 11 unveil all those. We're not going to do that today. We're going to kind of fast forward to then this final judgment. I will say, as we're wrapping this series up this week and next, if you have any questions about the book of Revelation, if there's something that we did not cover that's always just been eating at you, or as you maybe you've been reading this along with us, and man, you're just like, I don't understand, submit those questions to our hosts right now, actually. Interact with them. Let them know. If you're watching us on YouTube or listening to the podcast, you don't have that ability, you can shoot me an email at mark.coulter@thevalley.church, or you can text me 937-358-6565. I would love to answer those questions, or just let our hosts know and they'll get them to me. But next week, I want to spend a few minutes at the beginning of the service talking about some of the questions you might have. So we pick up today. We're in Revelation chapter 20, and it's verse 11, and it says this. This is, again, John, the Apostle John. He says, "And I saw a great white throne and the one sitting on it. The earth and sky fled from his presence, but they found no place to hide. I saw the dead, both great and small, standing before God's throne, and the books were open, including the book of life, and the dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up its dead, and the grave and death and the grave gave up their dead, and all were judged according to their deeds. Then death and the grave were thrown into the lake of fire. This lake of fire is the second death, and anyone whose name was not found recorded in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire." We see this defeat of Satan. We see this judgment period that all of us will stand in front of the judgment throne at some point and be judged. Are we in right relationship with God or are we not? It's so vitally important that we know what the Bible teaches us on hell. And so we're going to focus on talking about hell today. We are eternal beings, and the Bible tells us that we have an eternal destiny apart from God. An eternal destiny apart from God is an incalculably tragic thing. And so we need to talk about this. We need to talk, what's this judgment? How's this judgment operate? So often we think we're safe. We think we're safe because we said a prayer, or because we go to church, or we tried to live a good Christian life, or maybe we even believe that Jesus did die on a cross for sin, and that he did raise again. But the question I want to ask us all as we begin today is, are we safe? Are you safe when it comes to this final judgment that we read about here in Revelation 20? When we talk about hell, we tend to, if you're a follower of Christ, we tend to talk about those who aren't joining us today, aren't going to be on site with us, those who don't attend church. We tend to think of, when we say hell, we tend to think about people who are doing evil things, or people who are making bad choices, or people who would never step inside the doors of a church. And Jesus knows how easily all of us can be deceived. That's one of the themes in the book of Revelation, is it not? That the deception. A couple weeks ago, I taught about the counterfeitness. Satan is the ultimate counterfeit expert. He is a deceiver, and so we have to be aware. And so Jesus actually addresses church people on the subject of hell in the Bible. He does talk to us. He has an audience that knows the right things to say, knows the right things to believe, and he challenges them, and he says that they plan for heaven, but Jesus says they might just wake up in hell. And that's going to be kind of our bottom line today. They planned to be in heaven, but what if they end up waking up in hell? Jesus tells this story about hell. It's not a story in Revelation, actually. Revelation doesn't give us a lot of details about hell. This is giving us about judgment and a final judgment, the verse we looked at. He tells this story about a rich guy. This rich guy had everything that money could buy. He was wearing the best suits. He had the best clothes. He drove the best cars, if there were cars. Of course, they weren't in the first century. But he had the best of every single thing. Every night he had a party and people invited over to this party. He was the person to be around. He was truly blessed by God, or that's what the people of that day thought. They equated wealth with God's blessing. They equated being right with God with the blessing, material blessing. There's this other guy in this story that he tells by the name of Lazarus. Lazarus is a guy in a horrible condition. In fact, he is paralyzed or he can't walk. We're not told all his ailment, but he can't walk. He lays outside the door of this rich man. He's unkempt. His beard is not only huge, but it's dirty and it's scraggly, and he smells and he's filthy and he's got sores all over his body. Jesus tells us in this story. If he wants to get anywhere, his friends would have to carry him or someone would have to move him. There's no healthcare system at that time. There's no Social Security. There's no type of Medicaid or anything like that that exists. And so he had nothing. He had nothing to help him, nothing to move forward in life. And he lays outside this rich man's door. In fact, for the rich man to leave his house, he would almost have to stumble over Lazarus, almost like a panhandler. He pretended he didn't exist. He just kind of moved on. He never gave any attention. The story Jesus relates to us says about the only ones who gave any attention, who took any care of Lazarus and helped meet any of his needs, were the dogs of the rich man. The guard dogs of the rich man would go and lick the wounds of Lazarus laying outside the door of this rich man's home. Of course, the people listening to this story from Jesus would have said, well, Lazarus is getting what he deserves for his sin. It was a very commonly held belief in the first century that, and even before that, that if you were poor, if you were destitute, if you were an outcast, that was a consequence of the sin in your life. They equated God's blessing and rightness with God with material blessing and material possession, and the opposite of that was then because you were not a follower of God and because of God's curse on your life. Now, because life is terminal, right? I think George Bernard Shaw said that, for everyone who is born, one will die. Life is terminal. Ironically, the rich man and Lazarus end up dying at the same time. And they go to their eternal destination. And the Bible tells us that Lazarus is carried by the angels to the side of Abraham in heaven. Mentioning Abraham would have denoted it, that this was heaven. This was where the saints were. And the rich man ends up in hell. And so, again, the rich man plans for heaven, but he wakes up in hell. And like I said, if you're a first century listener, you're saying, this is just not right. This isn't supposed to be. The rich man's supposed to be in heaven. The poor guy, the bum, he's supposed to be the one that's in hell. And so we pick up with this story. We're going to be in Luke 16. I gave you the kind of the background of it already. And in Luke 16, the rich guy, even in hell, makes this request of the beggar that just is absolutely mind-boggling. So we're going to be in verse 23 of chapter 16. He says, and his soul went to the place of the dead. The rich man also died and was buried, and his soul went to the place of the dead. There in torment, he saw Abraham in the far distance with Lazarus at his side. The rich man shouted, Father Abraham, have some pity. Send Lazarus over here to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. I am in anguish in these flames. I mean, did you notice? Like, even in hell, this rich man has a sense of entitlement. He's like, go tell Lazarus. He can walk now, apparently. I guess he can go tell him to dip his finger in the water. I mean, absolutely mind-boggling. In hell... And we're going to learn a little bit more about hell in a second. And yet he still feels that he lords over Lazarus because he is wealth, had wealth, and because he had power. And then the other thing that we notice here, that even though he's in hell, he's still not repentant. There's no acknowledgement that he did anything wrong. There's no acknowledgement that he needed to change his ways. He's in hell. He's still showing entitlement. He's still unrepentant. Proves a very deep theological point that who we are here on earth, we're taking with us to eternity. We're not going to be a different entity or a different person than we were here. Very fascinating thing to consider. And so Abraham answers this request. It's in verse 25. He says, "But Abraham said to him, 'Son, remember that during your lifetime you had everything you wanted and Lazarus had nothing. So now he is here being comforted and you are in anguish. And besides, there's a great chasm separating us. No one can cross over to you from here, and no one can cross over to us from there.'" You would think Abraham would tell him, "Dude, you just got to fry, man." But Abraham actually has compassion. He says, "You know, you had your whole lifetime to change the trajectory of your life. The whole lifetime. You chose to live for you. But Lazarus here, Lazarus was faithful to God. He had nothing externally that would appear to be right with God. He had nothing externally that would appear that he's blessed by God. But we discover here that in the midst of his incredible pain and suffering on earth, Lazarus never wavered in his faith with God. The rich man is alone and he's cut off from God, but yet he still does not want God's presence. He still does not want God's grace. He still does not want God's power evidenced in his life. See, Jesus is telling us something here very huge that correlates exactly with the book of Revelation and specifically with the passage in Revelation 20 that I read about final judgment. Jesus is trying to warn us. He's trying to warn us that separation from God is real. Hell is real. And actually, ironically, hell is relational. It's not just some mystical place or whatever. There is a reality of the relational aspect that you will be cut off. A person in hell will be cut off from God's presence. That is the reality. There will be no presence of God. There will be no goodness in hell. And he's saying the tragedy is that some people are going to choose that. Some people are choosing that now. Some people are going to make that choice and live with that for all eternity. In fact, Jesus gave us three very clear descriptors of hell. I don't know if you ever noticed this or ever realized that the Bible tells us this. Three very clear descriptors of hell. He says in three real things. It's a real place with real people. Excuse me, four things. Real place, real people, real torment, and real fire. And he says, and all those things, they're all unchangeable. They will never change. The torment, the fire, the fact that it's real people, and it's a real place. And I've said it before, if you've ever joined us before, hell's a real place and real people go there. And that's where we get it from. Jesus himself told us that it exists. In fact, there's a lot of teaching today that says, well, hell doesn't exist. There's no way a good God would allow people or grant their wishes, and a very clear verbiage I picked there, grant their wishes to be separated from God for all eternity. And here's my challenge, and listen in as you're with us today. Who are we going to listen to get our information on hell? Some pastor or some writer out there who says it doesn't exist, or someone like Jesus who actually knows the answer? I mean, are we going to go to our popular podcast people or popular authors out there, or are we going to go through the source of truth? And there is only one source of truth, folks, and we gotta realize that all those books and podcasts, they're great. I listen to them and I read too, but man, if we don't allow the Bible to be our authority of truth, we will be unfortunately surprised. And we are going to be incredibly misguided, and it's going to hurt us incredibly poorly. Remember, you can plan for heaven, but end up waking up in hell. You can plan for heaven and wake up in hell. You can believe your whole life that heaven is your destination. Remember, Jesus' story here is targeted at church folk, not to those who are axe murderers or whatever, when we think hell is for those people. He's talking, this is a talking to church people. In fact, the context, the greater context of this chapter in chapter 16 is that he's talking to them about money and God. And he says, you can't worship both God and money. You'll either have one master, you can't have two masters, because you'll serve one and not the other. And so this is actually in that whole context about money and about who to serve. And he's saying, you can't not serve God and money. You can't serve God and other people. You can't serve God and your job. You either going to choose. It's either going to be God or it's going to be a lot of other things, but you can't have both to be in charge and be your master. In fact, they should have been taking some really copious notes here. They should have been listening really closely but they thought they knew better. And I don't know if that's changed in the 21st century, and I don't think it has. Right? We think we know better than Jesus on subjects like this. We think we can come up with our own kind of definition of what's true and what's not true, or what we want to be true. Yeah, of course, it'd be great to say that there's no hell and everyone's going to go to heaven, but that's not the reality, and we can't live in a fantasy world, ladies and gentlemen. Verse 15, let's jump back up to verse 15 in this. There's a dialogue that happens, and it says, Verse 15, then he said to them, you like to appear righteous in public, but God knows your heart. What this world honors is detestable in the sight of God. What he's saying is you can know the Bible, you can even memorize it, you can know all the right things, but God knows your heart. You can deceive yourself into thinking that you're good with God and wake up in hell. I didn't come up with that. Jesus himself said, you can deceive yourself. I can deceive myself. So many people can deceive themselves. The Bible tells us in another place that and at the final judgment, people are going to be standing and saying, Lord, I prophesied in your name. Lord, I helped people in your name. And Jesus is going to say, depart from me, I don't know you. Wow, right? Depart from me, I don't know you. So how does this happen? How do good people who plan for heaven wake up in hell? Guys like this rich guy, how do good people who plan for heaven, how can you or I be so deceived? Well, actually, verses 27 and 28 shed some light into that. Then the rich man said, please, Father Abraham, at least send him to my father's home, for I have five brothers, and I want him to warn them so they don't end up in the place of torment. If you can't help me, then help those that I love, he says. And actually, you notice again, he's making demands to Lazarus. Like, there's no repentance, there's no change, because who we are on earth is who we're taken into eternity. There's not going to be this thing that flips, or someone's going to pray us into heaven or pray us out of hell. Who we are and decisions we make, rejection or acceptance of Jesus Christ, what we do here on earth, we will take that to eternity. And Abraham replies, he says, they have Moses and they have the prophets. Let them listen to them. In other words, just like you did, they have the entire Bible, which Law and the Prophets would have been the Old Testament that they had available to them. They have that available to listen to. Let them listen, let them take heed and escape your fate. And then we see in verse 31, but Abraham said, if they don't listen to Moses and if they don't listen to the prophets, they're not going to listen even if someone rises from the dead. In other words, a miracle is not going to make any difference. If they're not going to seek the truth and if they're not going to listen to the truth, they're not going to be made right with God. Now, one of the things is the rich man didn't end up in hell because he was rich. There's nothing wrong with being incredibly wealthy. The rich man ended up in hell because he did not listen to the God of the Bible. He did not listen to what he needed to do, and he never repented. He never changed. He never allowed God to come in and be the leader of his life. Now, I don't know about you, but when I read this story, I find it incredibly disturbing. I'm guessing if you're listening today, you're finding it slightly or significantly disturbing too. And I think we have to kind of self-reflect a little bit and say, am I one of those persons in Jesus' audience? Am I one of those that he's telling the story to? Could I be deceived? Could I be someone who is a church person and thinks I'm right with God, but be incredibly deceived? Could I wake up in hell because I just don't get it? I thought I did, but I never did. I don't grasp the truth and do what Jesus told me. I heard Francis Chan give a sermon one time, and it always stuck with me. He said, the thing that keeps him up at night is this. People who think they're right with God and aren't and are going to be spending eternity away from God. And then those who are right with God, but they continually question themselves and never think they are. And I get that, right? Maybe some of you listening today, maybe you're on that camp where, well, I'm not perfect. We know our weaknesses and that, and we think, well, I don't know, you know, and we second guess our salvation. And I want you to not do that if you know you're right with God. And allow the Holy Spirit, I'm going to give you some application here, allow the Holy Spirit to confirm that in your heart. But this is a camp that even worries me more, frankly, because the Bible tells us several times that there's going to be so many people who think that heaven is their destination and they're going to wake up in hell after the final judgment. And my job is to speak truth and help you understand truth, not so that you are constantly worried about your eternity, but that you can be certain and assured of your eternity and not deceived or in limbo. So how do we do this as we wrap up today? What can we do? The first thing we do is we need to take a heart check. When you go to the doctor, to make sure your heart's in good shape and have your arteries checked and all that, we need to do a heart check. We need to find out, is Christianity really real to me? Is it about religion? Is it about rules? Is it about being a good person? Or have I really made a decision for Jesus Christ? And we need to allow the Holy Spirit to confirm that in your life. Here's some questions I ask myself. Is your heart growing in love for God and for people? That's a self-check, a heart check. Is your love growing for God and for people? Are you listening to and responding to the voice of the Holy Spirit, God's presence through the Bible? Are you listening? Do you hear God's voice? Do you ever seek out his voice? I'm not saying that you have it all figured out and you don't struggle with it. That's not what I'm talking about. But are you seeking after hearing from God? Are you spending time and allowing God's word to saturate? Now, again, don't hear me wrong that I missed reading the Bible for a week. Am I going to hell? No, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm saying is it relational? Is there any relational component going on here? Because if there's not, then the Bible tells us this is all about a relationship. Heaven's relational, hell's relational, and relationship on earth with God the Father through Jesus Christ. And the last question is do you value God more than any singular thing on this planet? Is he the king? Is he the Lord of your life? Again, doesn't mean you're not going to struggle with wanting this or that or struggle with your future and giving it over to God. That's not what I'm talking about. But are you desiring God more than anything else? When's the last time you did a self-heart check analysis on, is God number one in my life? Am I hearing and responding to what he has to say? Am I living in obedience to what he wants? Is my love for him growing? Is my love for people growing as a result of him in my life? Jeremiah 17:9 tells us, the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it again? There it is again, right? We can deceive ourselves thinking we know what is in our hearts. That's why David in Psalm 139 said the following. He said, Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my thoughts. Point out anything in me that offends you, and lead me along the path of everlasting life. Folks, that's not a bad prayer to pray every day. Search me, O God, and is there anything in my heart that offends you? Is there anything in my life that is not in line with you? God, I want everything. That's why the Bible says that David was a man after God's own heart. Now, it gives us hope. This is why I love Scripture, is David was not a perfect person. I mean, he affair, a murder for hire, essentially. I mean, you're talking about disobedience in a census that was taken. That was a huge thing. It cost thousands of people their lives, okay? But yet, he was a man. He wanted what God wanted. He was human. He was sinful. But yet, his heart was turned towards the things of God. Gives me hope. I don't know about you. The rich man is in hell, and he still doesn't repent. He knows that repentance is the only way to be made right, but he still does not repent. And so once you and I ask God to do an honest self-check, that we ask him to show us what's wrong, to show him what's offensive, then our response needs to be a response, if he shows us, of repentance. There is no way that you're going to stand in front of God someday for the final judgment. I'm going to stand in front of God someday for the final judgment if we've never repented in our life. Repentance in the Greek is metanoia, which means a change of heart or a change of mind. In other words, it's a 180. It means that we are going under a different control system. We have a different leader in our life. You can't lead your life and say that you've repented. It's just not possible. You have to give over control. You have to recognize and confess your sin and realize, acknowledge that God is right and you're not. Your sin was so serious that it sent an innocent man, Jesus Christ, to the cross. And that you repent. It says godly sorrow leads to repentance. It's not that you feel just sorry, but godly sorrow. Now, if you've ever been, I know I have, of those times where God just breaks your heart over your sin. over your disobedience, over your pride, over your whatever it might be. He breaks you over that, and it leads to repentance. Your one goal is to do this and to be everything that he wants us to be. It's kind of funny in this world. We spend a lot of time thinking about our future financially. We think a lot of time about thinking about our relationships. We think a lot of time about our careers. We think a lot of time about our family. But we don't seem to think a lot of time about our eternity. And that's why I'm preaching this today. We need to start thinking eternally in nature. This is true. Nothing I've said today is untrue from Scripture. There will be a final judgment. It is promised. Remember, the book of Revelation is a book of courage and comfort. This was a comfort to them, knowing even if their head got lopped off, even if they were burned and set on fire for their faith, even if they were fed to the lions, even if they were exiled, there would come a day when they would stand in front of God the Father and Jesus Christ, and he would say to them, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in a few things. Come and enjoy my master's happiness. And so as we close today, can you authentically say that you are in right relationship with God the Father through Jesus Christ? Have you repented of your sin? Have you acknowledged that Jesus, that your sin broke the relationship and the only thing that could fix your sin was a Savior coming in? You see, God has done everything for us. He sent his son on a rescue mission. You could go way back. That was our Christmas Eve sermon this past year. He sent God on a, sent Jesus on a rescue mission to an earth. Why did he send him if we celebrate Christmas? He didn't send a politician. He didn't send a government, a military leader. He didn't send a teacher. He didn't send a philosopher. He sent a Savior because the world needed a Savior to save us from our sin, and so that we wouldn't have to spend our eternity in hell. So many people think that heaven is their destination and they wake up in hell. My prayer is that you watching today, and I would encourage you to share this with others, would change those numbers. That we would at least, if anything else, share the truth with people. They're going to make their decision. It's free will, as we discussed last week. They're going to make that decision, but I pray and I pray and I pray, if you're watching today, that you make a decision for Jesus Christ. And share this with other people who you know that maybe have been deceived into thinking that all kinds of other things made them right with God, that they think they're going to go to heaven, but they're going to wake up in hell. Don't let them go another day without hearing the truth. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I pray right now, if you're watching right now, and you have never given your life to Jesus Christ, I pray today is the day that you do that. You would repent of your sin. You would confess and say, Jesus, I know now that my sin is really sin. It's not a flub. It's not just a mistake. It's sin. It's so serious business that you sent your son, your one and only son, to die on my behalf, to be the substitute for my sin so that I could be made right with God. You confess that. Maybe you list out to him, or you just generalize, it doesn't really matter, but you get real with him is what matters. You get real with him right now, wherever you are. If you're driving down the road, pull over or pray the prayer as your eyes are open, it doesn't matter. He's hearing the prayer. It's about your heart. It's about our heart. And that we would give our heart over to him. We would have a heart transplant, if you will. We would go under new ownership and under new leadership. God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for this book of Revelation to know exactly what we're getting into so that we can make the choices now that will lead us to repentance and to an eternity with you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.